Michelle Miller, co-host of CBS This Morning Saturday. We're dishing up second helpings of our stories on culinary trends and feats. Breakfast in America is evolving as the next generation of chefs looks to it as a new frontier of appetizing experimentation. Jamie Wax takes us across the country with a look at innovative ways people are ordering their most important meal of the day.
From traditional bacon, eggs, and pancakes, breakfast in America, while tasty, has lacked the creative focus chefs have given to lunch and dinner. But over the past few years, that has changed in a major way, giving customers a diverse array of thoughtfully crafted options.
Is it fair to say that breakfast is the new dinner?
Well, I would say you still gotta eat dinner. But what I like about breakfast now, and by breakfast I mean sort of that weekday meal. We're not talking brunch, but you got much more creative dishes, you have much more healthy dishes.
Adam Rappaport is editor-in-chief of Bon Appetit.
This is not the breakfast we're used to, though.
Yeah, it's a cliche, but you know, breakfast is the most important meal of the day. Chefs are now realizing that, and they want to apply their sort of attention to detail, their creativity to this meal, and I think the customers are responding.
Acclaimed chefs from across the country are bringing their A-game to the morning meal.
This is probably the second most ordered dish on the menu.
And many single out one chef as the pioneer of the current trend.
A lot of people credit you for sort of starting this new movement. Is that fair?
I'll take it. Yeah.
Squirrel is the tiny, bustling L.A. restaurant that is the baby of Chef Jessica Coslow.
I remember when I was opening Squirrel, a very prominent chef here in L.A. was like, I will never do breakfast and lunch. There's no margins in it. There's no alcohol. It's a young person's game. Good luck.
When did you know you had really started something that was culture changing?
Maybe right when I opened the door. I felt at that moment so many people responded to having a place that they could have a unique experience in dining, but during the daytime at a price that was more affordable. You got shack toast working? Okay, I need two all day.
From popularizing her twist on avocado toast to creating dishes like crispy rice salad disco and flat tots, an elevated potato pancake, Coslow has created a breakfast menu that is anything but typical.
I think what's interesting about Squirrel is that they proved that A, breakfast can be a moneymaker. You can pack the house, and you can also cook really creatively. You can come up with dishes that are just as tempting and invigorating and sort of eye-opening as on a dinner menu.
That is delicious.
So good.
Squirrel's influence has surprised even Coslow herself.
It is remarkable to see that there's an idea here that other chefs are starting to translate into their own work.
That includes Michelin-starred chefs like Daniel Rose of Le Coucou in New York.
This one is fermented for how long, Neil?
About 3 days.
And famed fine dining maestro Jean-Georges Vongerichten.
Wants to be healthy, colorful. We're good.
Jean-Georges now has breakfast service in 5 of his restaurants.
Do you think this breakfast movement in some ways is sort of pushed forward by young chefs like Jessica Coslow?
Totally. I mean, all those young chefs are really starting a new movement, and I really admire them for, you know, pushing forward. For me, breakfast now become my favorite meal of the day.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely.
To cook it and to eat?
To cook it, to eat it.
Could you imagine yourself 46 years ago saying that?
No, absolutely not.
3 years ago, Mason Hereford surprised many by landing the number one spot on Bon Appetit's list of new American restaurants with his New Orleans sandwich shop, Turkey and the Wolf.
Matcha on the side.
Hereford has also gotten high marks for his newer breakfast-focused restaurant, Molly's Rise and Shine, which he runs with his fiancée, Lauren Agudo.
This is kind of our piece of Americana breakfast sandwich. It's got sausage, fried hash brown, American cheese, griddled onions, and then ketchup. This is sort of one of the weirder dishes. It's a deviled egg tostada with peanut salsa and refried red bean, pickled peppers, onions, cilantro.
This smells unbelievable.
Yeah, I think that's one of my faves.
Even so, if you're a fan of traditional morning fare who finds all these new choices a bit overwhelming, Adam Rappaport says not to worry. There's still room for everyone at the table.
There's always gonna be diners out there. There's always gonna be the basic places that we all love to go to get our stack of pancakes or fried eggs and bacon.
Sometimes we just want a greasy plate of eggs and bacon.
Yeah. Let's say you might have had a drink or two the night before. You're just like, I just need some hash browns and bacon and eggs, and I'm good.
You may know Jed Tila from his appearances on Iron Chef and Chopped, but in Los Angeles, he's famous for a different reason. His family opened what's thought to be the first Thai grocery store in the U.S. I visited Thai Town with Tila to discuss how he's keeping his family's legacy alive.
This is a good landmark, right? Like, you know you're in the heart of Thai Town.
You can't visit L.A.'s Thai Town without hitting a few of Chef Jet Tila's favorite haunts.
Yeah, so we're gonna eat at Run Pear.
This is Run Pear.
Yeah, this is the first stop of the Thai Town tour all the time. I got you.
Where his heritage is showcased through culture and cuisine.
What I'll do is I'll basically like curate the perfect bite. So a little cashew chicken, a little piece of cashew, a little rice. It gets all pushed into the spoon. Then you clean off the bite to make sure you're eating, and this is how you take a bite. And that's how a Thai person should eat. Very efficient.
Tila put Thai Town on the map when he brought a guy most people recognized as knowing his way around the international food scene.
I told these businesses in 06, I was like, I'm bringing this guy named Anthony Bourdain in, and you might get busy. And then we blew these places out.
It's good.
That interview with the late Anthony Bourdain added to Tila's already growing reputation.
I'm going to do English muffin, poached eggs.
Which ignited on cable TV.
The dressing is dish sausage.
But to understand Tila, you have to go back to his Chinese and Thai immigrant roots.
Your family laid the groundwork for Thai food in America.
It's kind of a big responsibility. So in 1966, my mom and my father immigrated to Los Angeles separately. They met a few years later because it was a little outpost. It was all the Thai people that were coming and going were based in East Hollywood, right here in Silver Lake.
They opened a grocery store in 1972 that fed a growing immigrant community.
This really reminds me of the struggle that my parents endured. It's not a sad story, but it's time to put it to bed so my mom can kind of enjoy the rest of her life.
His family closed down that location 3 months ago, but it remains the treasured example of success that built a company and 7 restaurants.
I have a lot of memories of the store. They're all fun memories until, you know, I got into my teenage years and I was just angry at that point because I had no social life. And then once I had a driver's license, I drove away as fast as I could, dropped out of school, you know what I mean, working odd jobs, went back to my family, you know, begged them to work, and took over as a manager of the grocery store. While I was there, I had a group of non-Thais, you know, that were always wanting to, like, they just came back from Thailand, they wanted to cook dishes. Always asking, how do I make pad Thai? How do I make curry? How do I make this? And they were like, why don't you just do a cooking class?
And I was like, ding, ding, ding.
It didn't take long for those cooking classes to turn into front page news in the Los Angeles Times.
And that was it. From that moment, the next few days, I got hundreds and hundreds of phone calls. And that made me realize that there is a need for someone to communicate, not just write recipes, but I did these fun little interactive cooking classes. Lo mein means soft noodles in a nice, really thick gravy, which basically I still do on Food Network today. So that was it. That was the moment that I was like, I can do this for the rest of my life.
He would eventually open his own restaurant in Las Vegas.
Chef Jet Tila.
And land a guest spot on Iron Chef America.
Against Iron Chef Morimoto.
And I was asked to battle Masaharu Morimoto. Toughest Iron Chef, is scared to death. Walked into Kitchen Stadium, met Morimoto. It was one of those battles where like no one knew me, so they expected me just to get pummeled. It would make really good TV, right? Get some rating.
And the winner is Iron Chef Morimoto.
That would bring him full circle and give him a platform to share his roots.
So is it possible to cook pad Thai like non-sweetened pad Thai?
Yeah, if you control the flavors, you can make it any way you want.
Oh, okay.
So yeah.
These days, it's all about control.
But I figured we'd do a Chinese dish because that's my real roots. You know what I mean? Grandparents coming from China. We're gonna do a dish called dan dan noodles.
Control on the job and in his own kitchen.
I got to think about making noodles for dinner. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, you're not going to cook again?
No.
One and done.
I need to be efficient here.
And there's something else about Chef Tila.
Oh, my God, this is so good.
It's good, right? And it's fast.
Something in his DNA that just won't stop him from sharing what he's learned along the way.
Hi, I'm Michelle.
Hi, Alvin.
Hi, Alvin. Nice to meet you.
Are you good?
Something that's helped to revitalize this old neighborhood of his.
You see the faces changing? You know?
Yeah. Basically, a younger generation's taken over the older.
It's a one-of-a-kind food experience where you learn about Thai culture.
What's good?
One of our best sellers actually is the feng chi, which is, I want to say macaroon, but I hate saying that. Even though it's a coconut cookie.
It's gooey.
A little bit, gooey on the inside, a little bit of crisp on the outside.
It doesn't get much sweeter than this.
Grilled sticky rice with banana.
If you like banana and coconut, this is it.
Well, that's why you gotta come here.
Oh my gosh, can I get a scoop of that green tea ice cream?
Of course.
Food with ancient origins is helping women lead modern lives. We traveled to Jordan in the Middle East, where a cooking school owner is keeping her grandmother's favorite recipes alive, all while helping local women join the workforce.
Every one of you is making their own pot. I want you to add just enough to cover that hole. I want it to be like a nice creamy texture. This is actually my grandmother's house.
And in Arabic, grandmother's house means Bait City.
Did you all taste the tahini? And when she passed away, we decided we wanted to do exactly what she used to do and teach guests the dishes that she used to teach us.
So what we're gonna do here is the recipe for hummus. This is my favorite recipe.
And it's here that Maria Haddad Hananya teaches people from around the world how to cook a traditional four-course Jordanian meal.
Who wants to make dessert?
Let's go through the recipes here. Your grandmother's recipe.
Yes.
What are some of her favorites?
The maqloube. And maqloube literally translated means flipped upside down. It's actually a pot that you make with rice and meat, sometimes chicken, sometimes fish. It's a pot that was prepared by farmers a long time ago using leftover ingredients.
Today we're making it with eggplants and cauliflowers because they are in season.
These recipes are some of Haddad Hananya's earliest food memories, learned right here in her grandmother's kitchen.
My mom didn't know what to do with us. She had to go to work. And so she would bring us here, and my grandmother would put us to work to prepare lunch, you know? A lot of women used to think that it was shameful to work.
But your mother worked.
Exactly. What my grandmother always used to say was, there is no such thing. It's actually shameful if you're not working.
But Jordan's a country where women are not always welcome in the workforce. The World Bank estimates just 22% of women participate in the labor force, compared with 87% of men.
I'm very happy to say that we are all a woman's and all women's team. Woohoo!
It's a living that's transformed the lives of Amreem Amal and Majida Mohammed.
So you feel empowered?
Yes.
It gives me freedom, Mohammed says, to build my own home and to be more financially independent and also help other people in my situation. Hala Marisweed has taught at Bait City for 3 years. I love cooking, she says. I love teaching people how to cook, and I love cooking something that is from my own culture. Marisweed is Syrian, one of the many displaced during the civil war.
What happens when you engage with people, I mean, who are not from here?
I learn from them, she says. I take a lot of good, beautiful things from them, and we learn from each other. That's true for Australian tourists Leanne Tully and Cynthia Robinson.
This is the first time we've seen women out working. In all the hotels we've been to, it's men, which is good for their economy, but we're wondering where all the women were.
Now let's talk about how we boil chicken. Bait City is great because it breaks the barrier, so it opens up this platform of communication with the cooks where they ask them if they're about the hijab and about their religion. Nobody really is able to answer these questions unless you talk to a local.
Among Haddad Hananya's guests, the country's most famous supporter of gender equality, Queen Rania of Jordan. On her birthday back in 2015, the queen treated a group of 40 orphans to a cooking class.
First of all, Queen Rania, the way she portrays Arab women is very impressive because a lot of people in the West, they don't know what Jordanian women are. You know, they think that because they're wearing veils, they're, you know, stepped on by their husbands, they get told what to do. But this is not actually what the real deal is.
Still, some women who have worked here have faced struggles at home.
One woman was abused by her husband, and when she came here, her self-esteem was shot, you know, like it was very hard to bring her back up. And the second she starts giving classes to these men who are very interested in hearing what she has to say, she automatically, her self-esteem is boosted, and you really see a different woman.
And that kind of cultural exchange can make all the difference.
I'm so passionate about what I do, I don't feel like it's work.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Yeah. Now tap on your foot.
It's so pleasant sitting with the guests when they come at the end of the meal, because at first it's always awkward when you meet people.
Mm.
You know, it's hard to break this barrier.
There you go. Very nice. Perfect.
And the second you start cooking with them, automatically you become friends. You have a shared interest no matter what. All right, back to work. Now you work on your salad. Hala? Yeah. And they're always in a good mood, right? Because they're traveling.
And they're eating.
And they're eating. They're never hangry, right? Is that the word where you're
hangry.
Like angry and
yes,
hungry?
Hangry.
Yes.
Okay, so here's to Bait City. Cheers, everybody.
Acclaimed chefs Enrique Olvera and Daniela Soto-Innes are redefining Mexican food using seasonal and local ingredients. The owners of the hugely popular restaurant, Cosme, say their success is due to a mixture of happiness and hard work. We paid them a visit in New York City.
To understand Chef Daniel Soto-Innes.
So you want to put the face of the scallop down, right?
You must make the rounds in her kitchen. A fast-paced production line.
It's a formula that works when you have high energy and when you have passion.
Moving to a beat that feeds a myriad of palates.
And where are you from?
Venezuela.
Venezuela, and you? New Jersey. And where are you from?
California.
It all fits together for this 29-year-old Mexico City native who believes that everyone in her domain has the potential to run the show.
It's amazing to see that they can have a chance to run their own kitchen.
You see the tortilla ladies?
I don't think you can go to any kitchen in America and see this many women in it.
They're badasses. They're amazing.
She said it, not me.
Sorry.
That ability to see promise has come full circle because world-renowned chef Enrique Olvera saw it in her.
What was it about her that impressed you?
Daniela was, it's always been really high energy. I think she also knows how to belong to the team, but also command the team, which is the hard for chefs to understand.
After a chance meeting in New York, he invited her to apprentice with him in Mexico City, his signature restaurant that was ranked the best in North America. A few years later, he handpicked her to partner and run his first New York venture.
This restaurant, Cosme, has seen enormous success. Is that part of the secret, the diversity?
Happiness. The mixture of happiness and hard work and fun.
La Chiquis is the best dancer that you'll ever see.
Playing host is something both have taken to. Whether throwing their customers a five-year anniversary party or simply seating President Obama and the First Lady in 2016, even if neither chefs were there in person.
My niece was being born, so I rushed. I took a plane that day.
Were you here?
No. I was in Mexico.
Luckily, their third partner, restaurateur Santiago Perez, was.
I was called to the front of a restaurant, and they, very polite, they asked me, hey, would you have the private dining room available? And the guy gives me the business card, and it's secret service.
Did it click then?
It kind of did. It wasn't immediate, you know? I wasn't expecting it.
What did they think?
They loved it.
And that visit came before Cosme was named the best eatery in the U.S. on the world's 50 best restaurants list for their own unique take on their hometown food.
We have razor clams, but we caught them to make a star.
What this duo seems to have accomplished, mixing it up while keeping it true.
I mean, you're a classically trained chef.
And yet you say most of what you apply in that kitchen comes from your grandmother's kitchen.
I think we all cook from memory. You can't create something that you don't cherish. I think it's important for us to, as cooks, to understand who we are. I was trained in New York, and when I came back to Mexico, I realized I didn't know much about my own country. And little by little, we got to know our own cuisines, all the regional cuisines of Mexico, and we literally fell in love.
And true Mexican cuisine is what fuels their menu.
You see five similar things, which is the agave, corn, beans,
pumpkin chiles,
and on, but we wanted to showcase Mexican food in New York using the same ideal that we use in Mexico.
It's like taking a bath.
Consider this dish. Sea bass with its scales fried like chicharron.
Ah, it's so satisfying.
I love this.
Dressed with mojo salsa.
Drizzle it, make it nice and green.
Oh, it's gorgeous.
Yes.
I don't usually like scales, but.
Oh, wait until you try this one.
That sauce is everything.
Oh, she liked it.
I do. Okay, what else do we have here?
Or Arctic char in a turmeric ginger and sea buckthorn sauce.
And sea buckthorn is so good for your skin.
Oh my God. But this is so light. It's so not what people think of when they think of Mexican.
When you come to eat at Cosme, if you see, we like to have things that are vibrant and fresh. We want you to come out of the restaurant feeling happy and alive instead of overwhelmed and crazy.
And bloated.
Yes, and bloated.
Now that the duo has conquered New York, Los Angeles is next. The recipe for success, they say, is simple.
If you don't enjoy it, you can't persevere. Just find a good mentor that will elevate you and that will compliment you, and you will learn nonstop. Learning nonstop and seeing the results is really nice.
You can find more stories like this on CBS This Morning Saturday each weekend. And join us for live news coverage 24/7 right here on CBSN, available for free across all platforms. Thanks for watching. Take care.